Here at Calvary Chapel, we believe that the Word of God, the whole Word of God, from Genesis to Revelation, is something to be studied for today. That everything that's contained therein has a message for us.
Well, this morning we're going to continue our verse-by-verse study through the Gospel of John. We're starting chapter 6 today. Chapter 6 is known as the Feeding of the 5,000. I kind of give the title of this message this morning as Life Lessons from a Picnic, because this is like the largest picnic in the Scripture, or the largest meal. You know, there's a lot of occasions in the Scripture, in the New Testament, where Jesus is attending dinners and having meals. I think it's a normal part of humanity. We all need to eat to survive. And it's the biggest, like I said, the biggest meal in all of Scripture. You know, it's called the Feeding of the 5,000, but we know that was they were only counting men. You know, this week I heard a story about a guy that was going on a picnic. He was actually going to the beach, and he was going surfing. And he went by himself, and he paddled out there a while, and he caught a big wave, and the wave, like, tumbled him over, and he slammed the top, and all of a sudden he noticed there was a great white shark coming towards him. So he thought he better pray. Started praying that God would save him from the great white shark. The shark started getting closer and closer and closer. And he finally realized that God's not going to save him from the shark. So he prayed one more prayer. And he prayed to God. He said, well, I prayed that the shark would be a Christian shark. Okay? And right before the shark got next to him, he heard the shark say a prayer. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this meal that I'm about to share. So that's not a true story. You know that, right? This is the only miracle. This is a miracle in this story, the feeding of the 5,000. This is the only miracle that's recorded in all four Gospels. Did you know that? In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all record this miracle. You know, as I was studying for this week, I've read some strange commentaries about, you know, people that are skeptics and scoffers, and they want to try to say, oh, this really wasn't a miracle. You know, that God, there was guys that the disciples just had food hidden in the in caves, and then they brought it out at the last minute, and they shared it with all the people. Or that everybody really had their lunch that day, and everybody was being selfish, and they didn't want to share their meal. Then this little boy showed up, and they all decided to share their meals. But that's just crazy, isn't it? Because that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible says that this was a miracle, an absolute miracle. You know, even a non-biblical writer records this story. You know, someone mentioned to me once before, why do you always quote guys from church history, you know, and stuff like that? I'll tell you why I do that, because a few years ago, Pastor Don asked me to teach in the Bible college. He said I could teach anything I want to teach, and I said, well, I love history. I'll be glad to teach the church history class. So if you were here during Bible college over the last year, you know that I did teach the church history class, and I just love history. Anyway, there was a guy by the name of Celsus. He lived in the latter half of the second century, and he was a Roman historian. And I'm just going to write some of the stuff that he wrote. He wrote a discourse against the Christians. He wrote stuff out to try to discredit the Christians. But here's what he says about Jesus' miracles. He said Jesus, on account of his poverty, was hired to go out to Egypt. Well, we know that Scripture teaches that he did go to Egypt as a baby. Here's what Celsus says, though. He says, while Jesus was in Egypt, he acquired certain magical powers. He returned home highly elated at possessing these powers, and on the strength of them, he gave himself out to be a god. It was by means of sorcery that he was able to accomplish the wonders which he performed. Let us believe that these cures, the resurrection, or the feeding of a multitude with just a few loaves. Did you catch that? These are more than just tricks of jugglers. Anyway, this guy Celsus, he confirms the biblical story to the effect that, yeah, Jesus did feed the 5,000. He did feed a multitude of people, but he says it was just it was some kind of a magic trick. But we know it was a miracle, right? Miracles aren't any big deal for Jesus, because he just enacts a higher set of laws, a higher set of laws than what we're familiar with, the normal laws of physics and laws of motion and those types of things. You know, it's just like if you see a 747 or a 757 or an airplane sitting on the tarmac, you think, That thing weighs tons. How is that thing going to fly? You know, you would say the law of gravity would say that plane cannot fly. But we just enact another set of laws, the laws of propulsion thrust and aerodynamics, and that plane can be lifted up into the air. So that's all that it was for Jesus. Jesus just supersedes the natural laws because he is God in a human form. He is all-powerful. He is all-knowing. And that's how he does those things. If you're taking notes this morning, there's four people groups in this passage. You know, let me back up a minute. I once heard a story about a little boy that was in Sunday school class, and they were all entering. The teacher asked all the kids in the Sunday school class, "What's your favorite Bible story?" And the little boy raises his hand. He says, "My favorite story in the Bible is the story of when the people loafed and fished," right? Well, they didn't loaf and fish, but there were loaves and fishes. And the four people groups in this story is we have the crowd. That's the first point on if you're taking notes. That'd be point one. Then we have Philip, number two. And then we have Andrew, and then we have the little boy. Those are our four people groups we have in this story this morning. And there's four subpoints in this story this morning. Letter A, or number one, would be problems do not escape God's eyes or God's view. Problems do not escape God's view. Letter B, or number two, problems test faith in God's power. Problems test faith in God's power. Number three, people are a part of God's plan. People are part of God's plan. Provision is abundant in God's time is number four. Provision is abundant in God's time. And I hope to bring all these principles out from this story, from the scriptures this morning. Principle number one, problems do not escape God's view. Verse number one in John 6. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Then a great multitude followed him because they saw the signs which he performed on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. Now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Let's go back and look at verse 1. It says, after these things. If you've been with us over the last few weeks, I've talked about this before because John likes to use this word. It's the Greek word metatauta, which translated to English to after these things. He uses it five times in this gospel, and he also uses it in the book of Revelation. But the problem is, he doesn't tell us how much time in between one event and the other event. If you remember, last week or a couple weeks ago in John chapter 5, it said there was a feast of the Jews. Okay, we don't know what feast that was for sure. Either it was the Feast of Tabernacles or it was the Feast of Passover. Either way, this is a long time between chapter 5 and chapter 6, because if it's a Feast of Tabernacles, that feast is in September or October, and now he's saying it's the Feast of the Passover, which is in the month of Nisan, which is our March or April time frame. So either way, either this is 6 months later from chapter 5, or this is a whole year later from chapter 5. So what happened in between that time? Well, John doesn't tell us. John doesn't tell us exactly what happened in all that time frame. But it does say in verse 2, if you look at verse 2 where I have it highlighted, it says, the multitude followed him because they saw his signs which he performed on those who were diseased. So why was the crowd following Jesus? Because he was a great teacher? No. It says because they saw the signs. They saw the signs. They saw him kind of for selfish motives. They wanted to be healed. Maybe that could be some of the reasons they followed him. If you think back in John chapter, at the very last verse in John chapter 2, it says that Jesus didn't commit himself to all men because he knew what was in a man's heart. Because even Nicodemus in chapter 3 said he came to see Jesus only because he saw the signs and the miracles. You know, there's a scholar by the name of William Barclay, another church history guy. You Duncans might like to know that he was a Scottishman. He was born in 1907. He was from Glasgow, Scotland. He was a Scottish author, television presenter in the Church of Scotland, and a professor of divinity at the University of Glasgow. And what he writes these words, talking about why people might follow Jesus. He writes this, and I quote, he says, "When we want comfort in sorrow, when we want strength in difficulty, when we want peace in turmoil, when we want help when life has gotten us down, there's no one so wonderful as Jesus. Then we will talk to him and walk with him and open our hearts to him. But when he comes to us with some stern demand for sacrifice, with some challenge to effort, with the offer of some cross to bear, then we will have nothing to do with him. When we examine our hearts, it may be that we will find that we too love Jesus for what we can get from him. And when he comes to us with this great challenge and great demands, we too grow lukewarm, even resentful and hostile to this disturbing and demanding Christ." Have you ever noticed somebody who's mad at God? Have you ever met anybody that's mad at God? I know I have. I've been mad at God before. I'm not going to deny. It's like, why did you do that? Why did this happen? Well, you might have heard somebody say before, "Well, I used to follow Jesus, but I'm not following him anymore because of what happened, because he made me go through something like this." I'll tell you what, if you come across somebody that's continually living that life, mad at God, I'll tell you why. It's because they got their theology reversed. They got their theology reversed. They think that Jesus is just their like giant sugar daddy in the sky. It's not that I'm the Lord and the God. Jesus is supposed to be serving me. I'm not supposed to be serving God. But that's just the opposite of what the scriptures are teaching us. We're supposed to serve Jesus. He's not our sugar daddy in the sky. He didn't promise us an easy road in this world. But you know what he did promise us? He promised that he would always be there. He would give us the gift of the Holy Spirit. And he would always, always be there. He would never leave you or forsake you. Remember he said that. Don't be surprised if the world hates you. They hated me first. So that's number one. Problems do not escape God's view. And you can kind of see this in the scriptures right here. Because it said the great multitude followed him because they saw his signs which he performed on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up on the mountains and he sat with his disciples. Now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes, and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" I got a word in parentheses right there, and that's a Greek word. It's pronounced theomi, theomi, theomi. That's where we get our English word theater from, theater from. If you've been with me for the last few weeks, we've talked about a couple other words in the Greek that have been translated to see or saw. Remember, the New Testament was written in common Greek. And the Greek language is way more descriptive than the English language. They may have three or four different words in Greek that we only have one word in English to translate to that. Just like we have here in see. If you were here a few weeks ago, in John 5:19, it says that Jesus was seeing what the Father does. And that was the word blebo. And that's the word translated to see, which means to discover by experience. Where we talked about where Jesus knew what the Father was doing because he saw the Father by experience. He knew what the Father was doing. There was another word that was translated to see in John chapter 5, at the beginning of chapter 5. And it's when Jesus saw the man sitting at the pool of Bethesda that was sick for 38 years. And that was a common word. That was just, I looked at it and I seen the guy there. But this is a different word. This is the word, like I said, we get our English word theater. What do you do at a theater? You sit there and you observe and you watch what's going on, right? So this is Strom's concordance definition of this word is to behold, to look upon, to view attentively, to contemplate. To learn something by looking, to see with the eyes, to perceive. So it's not that Jesus just looked and said, "Oh, there's people coming." No, he saw these people coming, and he knows now these people. He knows that these people have a need. He knows the human body. He knows he created us. He's the creator of everything. He knows that these people are hungry. and they need some substance. So that's number one. Problems don't escape God's view. Number two, problems test faith in God's power. So now we're introduced here also to Philip. Think about how problems don't escape God's view. Think about the let's back up to Matthew's gospel just for a minute. Everyone's familiar with the Sermon on the Mount. That's kind of like the high bar that as Christians and believers, this is where we're supposed to try to maintain our walk. It's, you know, the bar is so high that, you know, it's impossible to maintain that level that Jesus teaches at the Sermon on the Mount. But he still teaches about that. And one of the places in the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus is talking to his disciples, he's talking about worrying. It's off the Sermon on the Mount. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about the body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more value than they? Think about what he's saying there for a minute. God knows that you need food. He knows that you need clothing. He knows that you need shelter. He knows all those things. He knows all those things. Sometimes we forget that God knows all those things. The perfect man, the perfect God-man, Jesus came down and lived in a human body. He experienced everything that you and I have also experienced. Notice where I got that word highlighted there where it says your heavenly Father. But he's talking about birds right there. But the birds aren't God's heavenly Father. You are, I am, and everyone else that's accepted Christ by faith, we're his children. Now, if the Father cares about birds, doesn't he also more care about you? Think about this for a minute. No bird was created in the image of God. No bird is created in Christ for salvation. No bird has ever promised heaven and eternal life. But if you're God's child, you are promised those things. You are promised those things. I came across an interesting poem. In fact, it was in one of the books that was in the Bible college a few years ago, and I couldn't remember what book it was, but I looked it up online. And it's a poem written by a woman named Elizabeth Cheney. And maybe some of you have or have not heard of her. And it's a poem about birds. And I'm going to read it for you. The poem is called The Robin and the Sparrow. The Robin and the Sparrow. And it starts out like this. It says, said the robin to the sparrow, I should really like to know why these anxious human beings rush about and worry so. Said the sparrow to the robin, friend, I think that it must be that they have no heavenly Father such as cares for you and me. And isn't that just the truth? When we're going through a trial, sometimes we forget that God really cares about us and he really knows what our needs are. You know, I've heard somebody say before that either I'm going through a trial, I just came through a trial, or I'm just about ready to go back into one. And that's pretty much how life is. That's how life is for each and every one of us. Jesus notices our problems, and then problems test faith in God's power. Verse number 5. Again, Jesus lifted up his eyes, seeing a great multitude coming toward him. He said to Philip, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? Question. Why does he ask this to Philip? Well, I can give you my opinion. The scripture doesn't tell us for sure. But we do know that Philip was from Bethsaida because that's what it said in John chapter 1. And this is near the Sea of Galilee or the Sea of Tiberias, whichever you want to call it. So this is actually in Philip's hometown area. This is where this feeding is going to take place at. So Jesus is asking Philip, where can we buy bread? The hometown guy should know where we can buy bread for all these guys, right? Well, God is testing Philip's faith right now. So how does Philip do with this? Does he pass the test? We'll see here in just a minute. You know, he's not asking him because he wants information. He's just asking him because he wants to test Philip's faith, because that's what it says on the next verse. But this he said to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Remember, Jesus is omniscient. omnipotent. He knows everything. He knows the future. He knows the past. He lives outside of time. But he was testing Philip just to see how Philip was going to react to that. You know, a lot of people give Philip a hard time about the way he answered this question. Because this is what Philip says. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them have a little. Have a little. So there's a difficulty going around. They have a problem. The people are hungry. Jesus is inquiring with Philip, how are we going to solve this problem? And Philip's, you can hear, think about Philip for a minute. His little calculator mind's going, blah, blah, blah. Okay, I got the answer for you, Jesus. It's going to take 200 denarii. Or $10,000 to feed all these people. Wrong answer, Philip. That's the wrong answer. He gave the wrong answer. Why? Well, because think about Philip for a minute. What had Philip seen over the last couple of years? He saw the water getting turned to wine at the wedding at Cana, right? He saw all the miracles that Nicodemus mentions in chapter 3. He saw Jesus heal the nobleman's son. He saw Jesus heal the man that was sick for 38 years. But right now, he's thinking strictly worldly. You know, he's thinking like a pessimist, right? All of you know the optimist, pessimist things. You know, I heard a story one time about a farmer, about two farmers, actually. One of them was an optimist and the other was a pessimist. The optimist loved God, prayed every day, had a relationship with Christ, but his neighbor was a pessimist. His other farmer neighbor was a pessimist. And one day, it was a beautiful sunny day, and the optimist went and talked to the pessimist, and he said, "Isn't this just a glorious, beautiful sunny day that God has given us for the sun to shine on our crops like this?" And the pessimist looked at him and said, "Yeah, if it stays sunny like this, our crops are going to burn up and die." So the next day, it was raining. Same two got together. The optimist had a conversation with the pessimist. He said, "Oh, look at this wonderful rain that we've got from heaven. God is watering our plant, our crops. We're going to have this great harvest." And the pessimist looked at him and said, "Yeah, if it keeps raining like this, it's going to wash all our crops out." Well, this went on day in, day out, week in, week in, month after month. Finally came the winter time, and it was hunting season. It was duck hunting season. And the optimist thought he has him now. I got something that he's, this pessimist guy is not going to get around. So he asked him to go duck hunting with him. They went out on their little boat. They seen some ducks. They shot some ducks. The optimist had a dog in there. After they shot the ducks, he told his dog to go get the ducks. The dog jumped out of the boat, ran across the water, grabbed the duck, and ran back across the water again, got in the boat, and the optimist looked at the pessimist and he said, "What'd you think about that?" And the pessimist just shook his head and said, "I can't believe it. Your dog can't swim, can he?" That's Philip right here. He's the pessimist. You know, they say that when two pessimists meet, they don't shake hands. They just shake heads, right? That's Philip. What would have been the right answer for Philip to give? I'll give you one example of what I think what a good answer would have been for Philip to give to Jesus. He could have said, "Jesus, I've been watching you, and I know for sure there's not a bakery anywhere in this part of the country big enough to make bread for all these people. But I know that you don't need a bakery, because I know that you can do something about it." But that's not what Philip said. And so that would have been a passing answer to the test. Principle number 3, people are part of God's plan. We see that now as Philip is introduced here into the story. Then one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him. So we're introduced to another character in this story, Andrew. What do we know about Andrew? We met Andrew back in chapter 1. What is Andrew known for? Andrew. That's a tough one. What is Andrew known for? The gospel according to Andrew. It's not there, is it? The letter to the Romans by Andrew, it's not there either. Did he write any great letters or any epistles? He may have, but we don't have any record of that. What Andrew is known for in the scriptures is always said, Simon Peter's brother. Maybe some of you are the younger sibling, and you know how that feels, to be the younger brother or the younger sister of somebody else. I was the oldest, so I never had to deal with that. But could you imagine being one of Jesus' younger brothers or sisters in his family. Or Mary and Joseph would be saying, why can't you be more like Jesus? You know, that would have been tough. That would have been a tough one. I'll tell you what we do know about Andrew from the scriptures. Back in chapter 1, what does he go to do after he meets Jesus? He goes and gets his brother and brings him to him. Here again, now we have in chapter 6. What is Andrew doing? He's going to bring this little boy to Jesus. And then later on in chapter 8, we'll see again that he brings a group of Greek seekers also to Jesus. I like guys like Andrew. We need more Andrews in the world. More Andrews, when they meet Jesus, they want to bring more people to Jesus. Back to church history again. You've all heard of a guy named D.L. Moody, right? Most of us heard of him, the great D.L. Moody from Chicago, the Moody Bible Institute. How about the guy named Kimball? Most of us don't know who Kimball was. Well, Kimball was the shoe salesman that witnessed to D.L. Moody that influenced him to be a Sunday school teacher. How about Philip Millington? Anybody heard of him? If you studied church history, you may have. Philip Millington was a professor of theology in the early 1500s that tutored Martin Luther. He was the one that influenced Martin Luther in his theology and to write and translate the New Testament into German. How about Mordecai Ham? Anybody heard of Mordecai Ham? We've all heard of Billy Graham, right? Mordecai Ham was the guy that had a tent revival ministry in the 1930s when there were one night a 16-year-old guy by the name of Billy Graham walked forward and gave his life to Christ. The point I'm trying to make here, that you might think that you're unnamed, unknown, and insignificant, or unimportant, none of that matters if you know Christ and you bring somebody to Christ, because even though you might feel that you're insignificant, in the hands of Christ, only the sky is the limit. Sky is the limit. Jesus uses people. I don't know why God chose to use people. I don't understand a lot of things about his method of bringing people into salvation. But I know for a fact, because the scripture shows it over and over, and most of all of you can have a similar testimony, that God uses people to bring other people to Christ. Every once in a while, you'll hear a story about someone that comes to Christ through some supernatural means. But the majority of the time, it's because somebody else has witnessed to them and brings them to Christ. Verse number 9. There is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. But what are they among so many? I highlighted the word barley right there, because this tells me and you and all of us that this little boy was extremely poor, from a very poor family. So how do you know that? Well, because he's got barley loaves. Barley was the grain for the poor. That was the grain for the poor, barley. So these weren't, you know, you picture, oh, he's carrying these big bags of loaf of breads. No, think of like a little pancake. This was more like a little pancake, pita bread type thing, made out of barley. And when it says 2 small fish, if you look that word up in the Greek, it wasn't like he was carrying big catfish or even any type of size of fish at all. This was probably more like a relish or like a sardine or something. So it was just like a spread, because that's the way the word reads in the Greek. So what are they among so many? Then Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, in number about 5,000. Here's the mathematics of a miracle. 5 loaves plus 2 fish equal what? Not very much, does it? But 5 loaves plus 2 fish plus Jesus equals the sky's the limit. That's where Philip made the mistake. He forgot to calculate Jesus into his mathematical formula when he said it's going to take 200 denarii to feed all these people. Well, he forgot the most important factor in the equation, and that was Jesus. Jesus was the most important factor. Never forget the factor in the power of Christ when you commit your life into his hands. That's what he can do for you. Here's our fourth and final provision, our principle, provision is abundant in God's plan. provision is abundant in God's plan. Verse number 11. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise the fish, as much as they wanted. Verse 12. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, so that nothing is lost. It says he had given thanks. So obviously Jesus prayed before the meal. So he was praying openly and in public. As an example, he's giving us an example. So whenever you go out to eat in a restaurant, I encourage you to pray openly. You don't have to make a big scene about it, but it's okay to give thanks and pray. And you might even ask your waiter or waitress sometimes, hey, is there anything I can pray for you for? Because I've done it before. And I've been with other people that do it before. And believe it or not, sometimes they actually say, yeah, I do need prayer. Can you pray for me? Or they want to pray with you. It's a blessing in disguise when that something like that happens. Also, I want you to notice, if you're reading through your Bible, look back at verse 7 and see what it says there. It says, Philip calculated that everybody would have just a little. Think about the difference here between what Philip thought it was going to take 200 denarii for each and every one of those people to have just a little versus what Jesus does. They all had as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, did you just hear the people in the crowd saying, hey, Philip, come here. I'm still hungry. Can I have some more fish and bread? And Philip's come up. Oh, okay. Yeah. When God comes through, he comes through abundantly. Abundantly. Not only does Christ perform a miracle, but he does it exceedingly abundantly above what anybody could ever think. Think about the wedding at Cana when we talked about that a few weeks ago, when he turned the water into wine, and I calculated it was 180 gallons of wine. That's over 700 and some bottles of wine. That was just more wine than they could ever possibly drink. The difference between verse 7 and verse 11, Jesus provided the maximum because Philip calculated the very minimum. Therefore, they gathered them up, filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves which were left over by those who had eaten. You know, if you go out there and you try to read commentaries on this verse, you'll find everything in the world out there trying to figure out how come there were 12 baskets left over. People trying to make this spiritual or allegorical. I think it's a lot more simple than that. How many disciples were there? 12. And each one of them, he sent each one of them to carry, get out a basket. I don't think there's any spiritual or allegorical message right there. It's just a matter of fact, there was 12 guys. There were 12 guys picking up the leftovers. Verse 14. Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, said, truly, this is truly the prophet who has come into the world. This is truly the prophet who came in the world. So when Jesus performed this miracle, he went exceedingly above anything that they could imagine. Apostle Paul tells us in chapter 3, verse 20, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Exceedingly, abundantly above. So in closing, the four principles from this study this morning were that problems don't escape God's view. Number 2, problems test faith in God's power. Number 3, people are a part of God's plan. Number 4, provision is abundant in God's time. Provision is abundant in God's time, not my time or your time. And I can see some of your faces right now. You're saying, yeah, I like what you're saying, Gary. I know what you're saying, that God provides. No, I'm just not feeling it right now. I'm going through something in my life, and God has left me hanging. Well, that may be true. You may feel that way. Notice that Jesus only provided barley loaves and fish. It wasn't steak and lobster. It wasn't what they might have really wanted, but it's what they needed. Sometimes what we think we need and God knows what we need, can be light years apart and truly different. God knows exactly what you need. You may not need anything more than barley loaves and fish. You know, trials and tribulations are kind of, they're different for everybody. You know, sometimes we grade the amount of trial that we're going through based on what we see somebody else going through. I'll tell you what, as bad as you might think life is right now, there's always somebody that's got it worse. I can guarantee you that right now. Some of you may or may not know that we don't actually send any, we haven't sent any missionaries out in this church for a while, but we do support a missionary group. You may or may not know that. Out on that foyer table, you might notice that there's some pamphlets out there that look like this. And we do take a portion of the money that goes into that box right there. We do send that out to support missionaries. Now, these guys, you might look in here and you say, well, these guys look like they're in the army. They are in the army. This group trains up chaplains in the Sudanese army. And I just want to read you a little bit right here about what happened in the last month or so with this group of missionaries that we support. So I want you to think about this for a minute when you think about how awful the trial is that you have in your life. And just compare it a minute to what is going on in other parts of the world. It says, I was in Russia with our team celebrating the Eastern Orthodox Christmas on January 7th. If you didn't know, January 7th is when the Eastern Orthodox Church celebrates Christmas. We were celebrating with one of the churches when I received a call from Michael, our senior chaplain. He called to inform me of the death of two of our men, Gabriel and John. I'm not going to pronounce their last names. Gabriel had graduated in 2015 from the chaplaincy training program, and John was being field training by Gabriel and would have been part of our class of 11. Michael shared this news that had come in from us from the front lines, where one of the forward military units had been overrun by the enemy. From what we understand, there were wounded and dying men everywhere. Chaplain Gabriel and John ran up trying to save other men's lives when they were ambushed and killed, or so we thought. However, when the military was able to retake the overrun position, they found that John was still alive and that he was critically wounded. He was transported to a hospital for treatment, but the medical care at the front was ill-equipped to care for him, for critically wounded patients normally died. I know from my experience that John's chance of survival were not good, but we prayed and God and we hoped that God would intervene, but God did not. As a war zone, South Sudan is very dangerous and hard in a hard place. Around the 21st of January, word came informing us that John had succumbed to his wounds and went home to be with the Lord. That was a difficult way to start the new year, but this was only the beginning. On the 23rd of January, Michael called to inform me that Chaplain Peter had been captured by the enemy and he was burned alive. He was on his way home to see his wife and two daughters. When he fell into the hands of the enemy, what happened next, we can only speculate. When his remains were found, he had been bound and had firewood all around his body. He was doused with fuel and set ablaze. Peter had graduated in June of 2015. He had been in the field for a little over a year before he was killed. In the last 16 years, we have lost 32 chaplains in the service of Christ in the field. He goes on and on and on. Eventually, what talks about Chaplain Peter's widow, they built her a small house. They built it out of cement blocks and tin. You think, well, that's not much of a house. Well, all everybody else lives in houses made out of mud, bricks, and straw roofs. So just think about that for the minute. The next time you think, my life is miserable, yeah, it might be miserable, but there's somebody out there that has it a whole lot worse. A whole lot worse. Could you all stand with me and let's pray this together. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You can recite this together. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Did you catch that at the end of verse 5? When God comes through, He comes through big time. When He gives you the blessing, it may not be the blessing that you think you should get, but after a time frame, when you look back, you think, that's what I really needed. And your cup will run over. Thank you.
Shield about me, You're my glory, You're the lifter of my hand. Thou, O Lord, are a shield.